Okay, is that then on time to start? We've just got one late comer, that's Joe, Councillor Walsh. She's on route from the North Wall, so she's one of the guys a little bit. So, just, have you got any other apologies for tonight? Okay, agenda item one, so I suppose can't have any declarations of interest.
Yeah, thanks, Chair. Can I declare a personal interest on item three? Because the paper refers to a project that we're doing in part to the DT, and I am employed by the evening. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Chair. Can I declare an interest in item four to my business? That's why I've got all the permission, so.
Okay, thanks, sir. You're just happy to read that no one's a subject of the party with you tonight? Thank you. Okay, two is the minutes for approval. The group had just one comment to make on this, really. We didn't think they were wholly reflective of the debate we had on our community values, so we'd just like to make sure that in the future our comments are actually detailed and noted a little bit more.
I think the issue, Chair, that other members agree, I'm not going to be over the debate, but there's some good ideas. One, drawing the debate on alternative ways of implementing or improving, such as lunchtime, etc. I did make sure that the officers were taking notes. I just want to reassure us that the notes and the ideas taken haven't been lost because they're not in the minutes. That's simply, that's all I've asked.
Other than that,
we
all have to agree them.
Chair, so I don't know if it's related to this, the committee noted the concerns expressed as to whether a report has been written in respect to the operation of arrangements for conducting employee employment bills. Did we get that information? I couldn't find it. Is that coming up later?
Yeah.
Chair,
that information hasn't been lost, it will be circulated to members. You're aware of this committee, particularly the committee, which has been matched to the attention of the committee, and then you'll circulate it next week.
Thanks. Okay, agenda item number three, writing services business, continuity and disaster report updates. Mike, would you like to introduce your report and then you can invite your comments from that?
Thank you, Jeff. I hope you all have my report, and I'm sure I'll get quite a few questions. I just want to go through it very quickly, because I understand that what I write can be a bit technical, and some people find that maybe a bit of a challenge. So I'll try to put it into more English terms, and without making it dumbed down. But basically, the report goes through some of the things we've been doing to mitigate the risks around business continuity and disaster recovery over the last couple of years, and what steps we still have to take and where we are on that journey. Okay, so going through the background, as you know, we've had a situation where the IT infrastructure has lacked investment for a number of years. The council put money in place a while back, and over the last few years we have been going through a programme of work updating the infrastructure and modernising where we can, with certain objectives in mind. It needs to, apart from being cost effective, it needs to be reliable, it needs to be secure, it needs to be well maintained. And that reliability and availability objective plays directly into the business continuity and the disaster recovery arena. So the two things go very closely together, but just for clarity, business continuity is the art or the science of putting processes, systems and procedures in place to make sure that the business can continue regardless of any upset, whether it be IT or whether it be a flood or any other type of incident. Disaster recovery is the process of getting everything back to normal if a disaster or an incident has occurred. So they're related, but they're not the same. So, as you will know, the largest risk currently in the IT arena for the council is the fact that we have both our data centres in the same building as they've been built there in the Treasury building. We are working to get those separated. But in the meantime, we've been doing other things as well that help to mitigate some of the risks that the council has faced over the last few years. So first off, the biggest and the most visible from your perspective has been the Windows 7 rollout, where officers and members have had new laptops and other equipment to help them work more efficiently. But at the same time, it has, for those who've got laptops, it's given them the ability to work from a variety of different locations. So we can work from home, we can work using, if we have a data dongle or a data card, we can work from other locations that are not served by Wi-Fi, or we can work in a number of different council buildings just by picking up our equipment and moving. So that has greatly increased our mobility and flexibility, and it plays into the business continuity arrangements of the council. We've also improved, within that project, improved the security of the system and the authentication. So when you log in, we have servers within the IT estate that take your username and your password and check that you are who you say you are. And assuming you've not given your password to somebody else, it will then let you into the system and off you go. Now, historically, that was all done within one data centre within the Treasury building. Well, of course, that adds, it compounds the risk that we've got of having the data centres in the same building. So we've split that and we've put some service outside the Treasury building. So we've got service here in Wallasey Town Hall, we've got service in Cheshire Lines, and in other locations that can handle that authentication and security. So even if the Treasury building data centre that houses the security service goes down, we can get people onto the network because we have other servers elsewhere doing that job for us. Moving on then as well, the next item there, storage area network, just to explain what one of those is. In basic terms, it's just a big box with hard disks, but lots and lots and lots. Whereas in your PC at home or your laptop, you'll have a hard disk that you can store files on. Well, storage area network is racks full of lots of hard disks that have some intelligence, but basically they're used there to store all of our shared files. Okay. They as well have our mobility, because we've now got two storage area networks, one in each data center, so that if one goes down, the other one actually has a mirror copy of everything we've got, so we don't lose anything and people can just carry on working. The next one, virtualization, this is quite a difficult concept to explain, but it's basically virtualization allows us to make cost-effective use of the hardware that we have at our disposal. So, in the early days of having Microsoft Windows servers and laptops, we would have had a server for every application, and that server would have had some memory, and it would have had a hard disk or two, and it would have just run that application. And actually, when if we'd been able to look at the utilisation, we'd probably have been using somewhere well less than 50% of the capacity of that box. We can use modern tools, software tools called virtualization platforms, to allow us to actually run what are 2, 3, 4, maybe up to 8 servers on one actual physical box. So we currently have about 250 Windows servers in physically within the data centres in the Treasury building and around the estate. That turns into currently somewhere close to 600 virtual servers. So we're getting a ratio of around about 2.5, 3 to 1 at the moment, and that will increase as we virtualize more of our applications. Of course, to do that, we need to talk with suppliers and make sure that they're supporting of that, because there are some systems that will not work without virtual platforms. So particularly some of the small, old systems that we have. It also helps us that the virtualization platform we use, called VMware, helps us because it has certain tools that allow us to automatically move systems around without any loss of availability to the users. So, as an example, we may have a problem with a virtual server or some disks within the system. The VMware system is being configured so that it will automatically shift those applications and affected applications somewhere else, and they will continue running and users will not see any downtime as a result. At the moment, it takes a member of my staff to issue a command, but even that is a whole lot better than it was a couple of years ago, when the story was if a system went down, we had to get a new server, build it, put all the software on it, and it may have taken days. So we can do things in minutes now, whereas it would have taken maybe days in the past. And in a few months, it will be automatic and actually won't take any time at all. We've also been working with Microsoft to rationalise our database infrastructure. So we use a number of different database products at the moment. Some of them, the majority of them from Microsoft, but a number of them from other vendors. What we are looking to do is to, wherever possible, rationalise and simplify the estates by standardising on the use of Microsoft's SQL Server product wherever possible, because we've already paid for that within the deal we struck with Microsoft 2 or 3 years ago. Our SQL Server licences are included. So from a strategic and a financial point of view, we want to stop investing in other products and get the best out of our enterprise agreement with Microsoft. Also, by standardising on one platform, it allows us, allows me, to actually get the best training for my staff. And by standardising on one product, it means that we can be more expert in supporting that product than if we were trying to support 3, 4, 5 different platforms, as was the case. We're now down to about 3, I think. So we're getting there. Next one, Office email, Office 365. You may have heard some talk about this, you may have seen some reports about this over the last year. We are moving our email servers out into the cloud, which means that we will not have any servers here for email, for the main bulk of our email, here within Wirral. We will have some backups so that if there's a link failure, we can continue to deliver the email. But actually pushing it out to Microsoft's Office 365 service means that even if our data centers go down completely, if you, if any officer, if any member can get on the internet, they will still be able to get their email. And that is probably the biggest single system that we all rely on across the council. It is, apart from the telephone, it is probably the only piece of shared infrastructure that touches every part of the council. We will be rolling that out shortly. We're just entering a phase of testing to make sure that it works. There are a number of issues that we have to be mindful of, issues that I've come across in the past. When I was working at Blackwell Darwin, we changed from an older version of Microsoft Exchange email to their latest one, as was then, and we found that if we didn't get it right, we found problems with people's diaries more than the email, particularly for executives and the senior members, so the leaders of each party, who have generally got somebody helping them manage their diaries. And the problem we came across was we didn't manage it properly and migrate those related populations, so the executive and their personal assistant, and the leader and his personal assistant, at the same time, with one diary in the old system and one diary in the new system, things like appointments would disappear and it became quite difficult for them to function. So we have to be very careful to get that right. Moving on then, wide area network, we've signed a contract with DT and we are going through the moment design and discovery with them over the next 9 months to a year. They will replace our and update our network, and it will give us increased resilience. As an example, here in Wallasey, we are going to have a second link to the wide area network coming in, and it will be diversely routed. So, as an example, and I don't know whether this is true because I'm not close enough to it technically, if we currently have one BT data line coming in on this side of the building, when we finish with BT, they will bring another one in on that side of the building, so that if there's an incident where somebody digs up the road and cuts the cable on this side, it won't matter because we will have full capability to carry on running through the other link while that one is repaired. Ideally, I would like 3 links, because that's the optimum for full redundancy. However, the cost associated with providing 3 diversely routed links is not justifiable given our budgetary position today. And moving on then, we're close to the end now. The target operating environment, 2.3.7. What that is more or less is an update of our server operating systems, a bit like the Windows 7 rollout of laptops. We're doing the same for the servers. That operating system goes out of support, went out of support generally in July of this year, but we have an arrangement with Microsoft that keeps us in support until at least July of next year. And in the intervening time, we have a plan to replace and update the servers that need to be physically updated, to update definitely the operating systems from the old out-of-date Windows Server 2003 that goes out of support, and we will update it to the most modern version that each application can support. So that will in our plan that will either be Windows Server 2008 or more ideally 2012, wherever possible. Because that will give us the longest life without having to do a major upgrade again in another few years' time. So that should take us here. If we can get to 2012, it should take us through till 2020 at least before we start having to worry about any upgrades. And finally, the data center project. As you know, the big split that we've been working on. We are currently talking to a public sector partner in the region who has some capacity. I'm unable to share their identity with you at the moment because it's going through their governance at the moment. They've asked us to hold off.
A secret.
It's not a secret, it's just not, it will be published as soon as it's been, as soon as their governance board and their directors have finalised their publication.
So it's a secret.
It's a secret. All right, can we just combine
this
with everyone?
So it's not a
secret. It's not published, but it's not secret.
Right.
And we are also working with the asset management group within the council to identify a building or buildings that can be potentially repurposed into a second data centre. Some people have asked me why we're not looking at putting that second data centre out into the cloud. We are talking to Microsoft. However, indications at the moment are that the cost would be too prohibitive given our budget at the moment. So that's where we are. I invite any questions. Surgery beginning July. I've been working currently 2 days a week and in a phased return to work. And with the time available to try and do everything, we got it to a point where we felt it was fit to be published, but that aware that we may have to do some additional explanation of one or two points. But we did strip out as much as we could within the time available.
I take your point if you can offer them sort of to hear that. I hope you're feeling better now. I think if you're writing the report anyway, you know, if you write a report, it takes as long as it takes to write. But that's a minor point anyway. I mean, I think the major issue with this is obviously this was highlighted as a major risk to the council in the audit risk management committee last Christmas. Specifically, one of the big issues is 2.38 with the data center project. It seems that we still haven't identified a site a year later after it was highlighted as a major risk. And we knew about this before last Christmas as well. I'm just wondering what's the timescale for this actually finished and in place?
We are hopeful that our public sector partner will be ready to go ahead very soon. And should that be the case, as soon as legal contracts are drawn up and all of the governance arrangements are gone through, we should be very quickly able to take one of our data centres and move it out. And at that point, the risk is gone. Now that hopefully will be before the end of this financial year. But the governance arrangements and the procurement issues are the ones that slow us down. That certainly on the other side, looking for a data centre building, we've had We've looked at a number of buildings, I think about more than six so far, and different sites. After we got down, we have currently got down to two potential sites. We still have not had a decision from the asset management group as to what their favoured building is. Now, we are ready in IT to go ahead and instruct planners to help us to design the best data centre solution, but we're waiting for that final decision. But the risk will be mitigated as soon as we get the first data centre out from the Treasury building, and I hope that that will be in the next few months.
There isn't a firm date for it. It's not IT who are setting the date. It's the
There are external factors that are holding the date up. We're ready to go, and our plans are well ahead for migrating our equipment out. We're just waiting for the final go-ahead, really.
Just on the actual disaster recovery and business continuity as a whole, does Wirral now have a disaster recovery plan in place and a business continuity plan in place that would cover both situations? And then how far are we in completing the actual infrastructure that's behind that, so that if we went down tomorrow, would we be back up and running? How quick would we be back up and running?
We have a number of plans in Wirral. The business, on the business continuity side, that is being led by Mark Campbell and Ruth Jones. Every department and every directorate has been tasked with providing, building their own business continuity plans, because it's about how they keep their business running. I've just been given a first sight of the ones that have been returned to them from an IT perspective, so that we can then start planning to see whether we need to modify anything within our plans. Within the IT side of things, our business continuity plan is formulated, and it's basically, if we can't get into the building but the IT is working, which is for us the only business continuity issue, then we work from home. Anything else, so if the IT goes down in any way, shape or form, either the whole of the IT goes down and it's a complete disaster and we have to build everything back up from scratch, or more likely we have a system or a service goes down, we have and we are building disaster recovery plans service by service, and we are building them as well so that where those services interrelate, so if we're using a common piece of hardware for two services, then that will all be part of the plan. But normally, we'll have a disaster recovery plan for email, we'll have a disaster recovery plan for social care systems, for finance systems, etc. Those are in train, they are not complete.
I don't know if I can just comment.
One final point on that comment.
Yeah, it was in relation to that. It wasn't to stop you asking another question, it might have just been useful. This report is also going towards the risk management on Monday. Given the situation with task and finish on community libraries and the agreement we had last week, it would be an idea to put this to the top of our work programme, and we could start that pretty quickly, and any concerns that we've got, we could pursue further. So that's, I was just thinking.
Just one final point then. From what I take there, the council hasn't got a full disaster recovery plan, hasn't got a full business continuity plan, and so has never had one. These aren't reviews, these are putting in place for the first time. And just one final point on that.
Well, is that novel,
given that you've worked in other councils, is that novel that we're all doesn't have a disaster recovery plan? I think, and so,
I think you've got a word to do that there.
I do not know whether the council has ever had a full disaster recovery plan, because I don't know what happened 10, 15, 20 years ago. There may have been, but at the moment there is not. And as far back as I can see in terms of the records, there has not been a complete plan. And certainly is something that is something that needs to grow and be updated regularly. So then, even if there was a plan 5 years ago, it would be wrong for today because we've updated the systems and it needs to be updated. What has happened in the period before I joined, in that period of where there was a lack of investment, it wasn't just a lack of investment in the technical infrastructure, hardware, software, comms, it was also a lack of investment in terms of the development and the staff. And actually there was a lack of capability and capacity in the right areas to maintain and revise and develop those plans. That is now in place. We've now got a full senior management team since the end of June. It is on our radar, and each of us has a section that we will be working on over the next 12 months to pick up those disaster recovery plans and those business continuity plans and get them built as quick as we can. And if we have come across areas where we feel we need additional capacity, I will go and talk to SLT and put a business case forward to get that additional capacity.
Chris, I am mindful of how long we've spent on this. Lots of questions has been asked, so if you
have okay. Yeah, I've only got 50 questions.
Can you put it down at home?
I have like most of you. Quick question. I was looking at the VMware.
Yes.
I don't know how that decision was made because I was looking at the VMware utilises the government's looking at using the G Cloud, call it, government cloud, and they've got a report coming out. I don't think it's out yet, it's due out this month, September. And they're shying away from VMware because of the cost issues. And VMware, this may be a conversation you're not going to, it's not here, but on a 300 server farm, we're looking at a 31% increase in cost using VMware because it's pretty quiet. So, and I know the government's been walking away from that. I was just wondering how come Wirral as a council decided to go down the VMware.
That is a historic situation that I've inherited. VMware was, and still is, the market leader. And has a huge portion of the world's market in virtualization. It was a product that was bought and implemented by Wirral more than 5 years ago, I believe.
Right.
So I've inherited that. Strategically, when that contract comes up for renewal and we start to look again, we will look closely to see if there's something more cost effective. As an example, again, some people shy away from it, but we have an agreement with Microsoft, I think an enterprise agreement, which is a bundled agreement of a lot of different pieces of software. Whether we use it or not, we are paying and we have the right to use it. They have their own virtualization platform, called Hyper-V, which we could use, and it would actually, we could save the cost of VMware. What we need to be mindful of is in thinking about migrating from one very complex product to another is the risk and the cost of migration as well. So you'll have to do a very careful study and see whether it's worthwhile.
Well, I did some doing quick figures. I'd like to say 300 servers are 460,000 proprietary. If you go open source, you're looking at around about 320.
I think it would probably be in the best interest to have sort of that's half an hour. I just need to explain there, actually, I did mention about the task and finish, and I'll bring it up to this agenda item. Myself, Chris, and I met with Joe Walsh last week, and we discussed three pieces of research ongoing at the moment into community libraries, which meant that we felt it would be more beneficial to postpone that particular piece of task and finish until we've had the results through, so they could probably inform our scope. Best than just starting with the task and finish now, whilst all this is ongoing, which is why we think it would probably be best to bring this piece of task and finish up to the top of this. I thought I'd mention it now because it wouldn't make any sense in what I've just said. So people are in agreement there.
Yeah.
Thank you for that. You'll let me go now.
Thank you very much.
So instead of the recommendation, which is for a fair report to be presented in 6 months' time, if we agree to initiate a piece of task and finish in a timely fashion. Okay. Right, so moving on to the floor, it's the customer relationship management system, and Julie, you're going to present your report. Manage those emails and gave us contact details.
around the fact that we've developed a lot of electronic forms, e-form for them in the CLR. You don't need to say about what's the efficiency for those that they provide 24/7 correspondence with ability for customers to be able to contact us. The fact that they are integrated back into the CRM provides us with efficiency and removes having to manually adjust things and stuff. So there's been a whole suite of e-forms that you'll have seen that are going straight back through to the CRM system. We've also purchased other online packages. Again, hopefully they'll be simple to use. They, most importantly for me when I've been looking at customer contact, a lot of our queries, I'm sure queries that you have received, are about people wanting to progress chase. This is around street scene areas. And this allowed us to be able to feedback to the customer directly where one of their situations was up to. That's a really key thing and has reduced contact at call centre and to one-stop shops. As you know, the council's website has been improving over the last year. We've had a team of people working on the web content, saying to make that simpler, easier to find, to support directing people to online services. We're not about, as you know, just driving everybody to do everything online, digital by default. We are there to, where we can support people to go online, where we can't, we still have appointment services in the one-stop shop and the call centre, and obviously the online forms there to support those that cannot help themselves. We have staff in the library centre there to support people to use the online services too. But I think the key thing, and it's not rushing through the report, but the key thing for this report is that this system that we've had for, I keep saying, for 10 years, technology's massively increased and emerged, as you know yourself, over the last 10 years and significantly changed, that this system's now out of date and we need to change it. We need to make it so that it's more responsive for yourselves, to iron out some of the glitches that you've already had when you've been trying to use the current systems that we've got. We need it to support the Council's 2020 vision. It needs to be a system that's supportive of businesses, of the environment. It needs to be a system that isn't just our front door, a term of coined phrase often used, our front door to council services, but also front door to public services, to health, etc. things. So there's lots to do there. And if you turn over to our key deliverable, as a team of people looking at what we think the system, a process requires, we put some of the thoughts here on what we think a CRM, a 21st century fit for purpose customer contact system will need. These are our thoughts, they're in line with other authorities, they're in line with what government's doing in terms of single accounts. More importantly, some of the things here you will see tangible benefits from. A single online customer account, meaning you don't have to input information time and time again, meaning the customer has one reference number, so that will hold all their details, whether it's a revenues benefits query, the most complex or the most simple. It's there and easy for them to see all the interactions that they have made in one place. So all customer contacts are contained in one place. As I said before, one of the key things we feel is that customers need